So I'm Xander Ashwell. I'm the Director of Accessibility and User Experience at Rare. And as Tara says, we've been working on Sea of Thieves for a while, 6 years live, more obviously in development before then. And I think of the 150 plus updates we've shipped the game in that time, at least 50% of those updates have included some form of accessibility improvements, whether it's a new feature or improving on existing features. And so as a live service game, we frequently do small things and large things to kind of support accessibility. So I thought I'd talk a little bit about our audio aim assist feature. Apologies if I talk really quickly. That's something that apparently I do.
It literally just worked,
didn't it? Have to point it at me, at the laptop, at the thing. Or is it just going to...
Does it just hate you?
Just hates me. I'm pressing the... Thanks, do you want to just stand there? Cool. So super quickly, what's the problem space that we're looking at today? How are we going to improve those things? Did it work? And what lessons did we learn from it? Fixed it, thank you. So, as I said, I'm Xander Ashwell, I'm the Director of Accessibility and User Experience. My pronouns are he, him. I am a middle-aged white male, I don't know, visual description of me. I'm a look like a stretched hobbit. That's probably fair. I'll also be talking about Chris Marlowe, who's our principal gameplay engineer. For those of you who haven't met Chris, he's a wonderful guy. He is a talented opera singer, and for Rare fans in the audience, he is the voice of the great Mighty Pooh. And John Vincent, who's our senior audio director, who, again, just an incredible individual. I had very little to do with audio aim assist. And as director of accessibility, you might think that's a terrible thing. And I actually think that's a win for reasons that I might go into later. But how did this come about? So, super simply, Chris Marlowe, who I just mentioned, our principal gameplay engineer, crewed up with Silas Combat, who's in the audience today. And that was just a social thing. We have engaged Silas as a paid consultant on Sea of Thieves previously, but this was just a kind of social event. And it was super insightful, and Chris came away from it kind of really buzzing with all the stuff that he learned about the way that Ben interacts with our game and the way that, whether it's through accommodations that we've built within the game or whether it's through Silas Combat and his crew kind of working out the way to make it work for them. It's just always super interesting to play with someone with lived experience of those accessibility requirements. And so what does the problem look like? Well, loosely speaking, it's people with low or no vision can struggle to be effective with handheld ranged weapons in Sea of Thieves. And for those of you who don't know what Sea of Thieves is, it's a shared world pirate game. You can be the pirate you want to be. You can sail all over this world that we've built. You can fire yourself out of cannons. You can kill skeletons. You can do a whole bunch of things. It's worth mentioning that in this statement that players with low or no vision can struggle to be effective with handheld ranged weapons, that's because of choices we've made or unintentional bias from our own exclusions within that title. So that isn't that people with low or no vision aren't good at shooting skellies. It's that the experience that we've built doesn't let them shoot skellies. So that's the problem space. And as luck would have it, Chris Marlowe, the very person who was sailing with Silas Combat on this particular day, was working on aim assist for controller players in Sea of Thieves anyway, which kind of exposes all of the stuff that you might need to build an audio aim assist feature. So that's serendipitous, isn't it? But he couldn't tell Silas about that, of course, because it hadn't been released yet. But he was super excited, and he came back to the studio and prototyped something super, super quickly. So what would the solution look like? Well, it involves audible cues. Well, what's the right amount of information that we can put into the audio space? What's the right amount of information that we need to pass on to somebody else to be able to aim at a skelly and shoot its head off, skull off? Well, we need to communicate where the target is in the XY space within the audio modality. So you already have that information in the visual modality. Let's communicate that in the audio space. And also communicate when you have sights over the target and when they fall off the target, right? That's also important. We can tell you kind of where you're aiming at or where the target is, but communicating when you're on and when you're off the target is also super, super important. We love this, don't we? Where can we beg, borrow, and steal from? Who else has done super cool things that we can half inch or be inspired by? Geiger counters are a really interesting bit of tech because they translate positional info that's spatial via the audio channel, right? Like you are communicating something that can't be seen. You're communicating how strong something is that's kind of radiating in a way that lets you determine spatially how strong or weak that signal is. And Forza, amongst others, have also done great work in this space for things like audio steering. If you haven't tried this out in Forza, they've got some really interesting learnings from how they implemented their kind of audio steering guide using the panning of the audio channel. And then how can we build a system that kind of ties in with the world that we've built? We've built this really rich pirate world. Just to kind of implement a Geiger counter would feel a bit odd, right? Like to implement some bleeps and bloops, that's not the game that we are. So how do you make it work? Well, we already have some tonally appropriate sounds from the game. So John Vincent, the audio director that I mentioned, used clicks from our audio for loading and unloading a ranged weapon, and used our harpoon sound. So in the game, you have harpoons that are bolted to your ship or bolted to parts of the world that you can use for kind of shooting things and reeling them in. So we didn't repurpose those sounds exactly, but we used those kinds of sounds to make it feel like it fitted within the game and make it feel like it was kind of tonally appropriate. And then we had to kind of match the relevant visual audio into the audible space, right? So what we're not going to do is to provide a superpower that gives you a ton more information in one sensory modality. We're not going to change the meta significantly. What we're going to do is kind of democratize the information that's currently locked into that visual space by making it available in the audio space as well. What follows is a video of someone using this in the game. Hopefully we'll have the audio channel coming through as well. For folks with low or no vision, this is a video of a kind of tropical island. There's someone in first person view holding a pistol, and they'll be kind of like scanning across the scene, trying to lock on onto a skeleton. Fingers crossed it autoplays. I can hear it on the jabber. Technology. Got it. So what maybe didn't come across from this mono Jabra output is that the audio is panning left or right depending on which way you're aiming. So you're basically trying to follow where the audio panning is. So if you're to the left, the audio will sit in the kind of right channel, which means you'll bring your aim over towards the right and vice versa. We change the frequency of the pitch based on how close you are. We change the occurrence of the pitch, the occurrence of the sound, how close you are to the target. So the closer you are to the target, the more frequent the sound is. And the further away from the target you are, the slower the sound is. And we change the pitch based on how high or low you are, right? So the higher you are, the higher the pitch goes up, and the lower you are, the lower the pitch goes down. So we use a few different kind of like audio cues to help you get a lock on the target. Cool, so how do we do? Well, Sightless is an absolute beast with it. It will surprise no one to hear, he's unstoppable, and it genuinely brought tears to our eyes watching him headshot skellies for the first time. Like genuinely, we gave Sightless this feature, turned it on, and he started killing skeletons immediately. It was awesome to see. So like that's always super heartwarming, right? If you kind of make a feature available to people and it kind of works, then that's super heartening. For those of you that aren't aware, we have an insiders program on Sea of Thieves so that people can play kind of early builds of ours before they get released to the public, and we get a ton of kind of user feedback from that, whether it's kind of heuristics and perception feedback, or whether that's kind of scale and stability feedback in our telemetry, we get a bunch of kind of targeted feedback around specific features. One of the things that we found that we were getting fairly consistently was when I mentioned the feature kind of using the speed of the ticks, depending on how kind of on target you were. We were implementing that both in the vertical space and the horizontal space. But what that meant was that if you were kind of the corners of your kind of target, the clicks were so slow as to be unhelpful. In a game that's quite fast-paced when it comes to kind of dealing with PvE and PvP especially, having kind of super low ticks meant that it was quite hard for you to kind of identify where the target was. So we tweaked it so that the ticks were only in the horizontal space rather than the horizontal and vertical. So it's only in the horizontal that we would change the speed, in the vertical the speed remained consistent based on how far you were horizontal. And cannons. So again, Sea of Thieves, we have ranged weapons that are handheld, and we have ranged weapons like cannons. Handheld weapons do have some drop-off, but cannons have significant drop-off because of the kind of nature of the projectile. And this is a kind of difficult problem space for us, because what we didn't want to do was to calculate where you had to aim the cannon to be able to hit the target based on how far away it is. And it's kind of a difficult challenge for us to solve, because the most intuitive solution to it, which would be attenuating the audio, so making it seem louder depending on how far away they were, kind of gives you false readings, because we already use attenuation for how far away they are in kind of 3D space. So amplifying that attenuation when you're on the cannon doesn't necessarily help with that audio cue. We have some good ideas of kind of how we'd like to kind of implement some feedback, but how we'd like to kind of extend cannons to be easier to use. But it's not an easy solve for us compared to kind of regular range weapons. What did we learn? Well, super important point, which is visibility, right? Like, we make stuff for humans. Humans are wonderfully diverse. The stuff that you make as game devs encounters that diversity at some point. So if you recognize and embrace that diversity, if you want to make wonderful stuff, then go play your game with people who aren't you. Something that's super, super valuable about inclusive design workshops, and we've done a couple of them at Rare now, is exposure to people with different lived experiences, and the way that they play games is one of the most valuable things that we can do as a game dev company in helping our company build more accessible experiences. And this is a super cool example of how, you know, Sightless and Chris Marlow crewing up together meant that Chris was just the right person to go do this work, because he was already close to the kind of aim assist stuff, which brings me on to my other point, which is when you're advocating within your organization for accessibility, include everyone. I know that I've heard some people reference in the past how, you know, like targeting designers is super important, because, you know, they're the people that make lots of choices about what goes into a game. I think that's fair. But the reason that this feature in Sea of Thieves came about was because an engineer was able to identify an easy win, and he'll hate me for saying easy win because, you know, it's never easy. But because Chris was already working on an aim assist feature, understanding the problem space and identifying that it was something that would be a kind of a fairly quick win for us wouldn't have been possible if it was anyone else. I wouldn't have been able to identify this as being the easy win without being that close to the feature that was being worked on. So all dev roles having exposure to players is beneficial, not just design or production, whoever it might be. And then the third point is, as I mentioned, Sea of Thieves has been live for 6+ years now, and has been in development for at least 2 years prior to that. And for a game in 2024 to be kind of 8 years old in terms of the decisions that we've made about what goes into the game, there's lots of stuff in Sea of Thieves which is inaccessible. And there's loads of stuff that we ship into Sea of Thieves where we've improved the experience, and some of it's been augmented, and some of it's been additive, and some of it's been kind of in the nuts and bolts. There's still good chunks of our experience that are inaccessible. And, you know, if you talk to Cyclist after this talk, he'll absolutely be able to share with you exactly which parts of the experience are accessible for him, especially. But it's better to ship better than it is to ship perfect, and it's better to increment an experience over time, which I think we've done on Sea of Thieves reasonably successfully. Because any improvement could be the one that unlocks someone's experience of that game. So rather than kind of holding on to things and going, we're not going to ship this until it's perfect, or I'm not going to ship this because it isn't the feature that we want it to be. If you continually iterate upon and improve upon your experience, then over time that leads to an experience that becomes more and more accessible, and that can be a good thing. Thanks.